Good evening, everybody. As we make a start to our service, I want us to stand up if we can and just want us to read from Colossians chapter 3. We're going to read from verses 12 to 17. This is the Apostle Paul under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. He gives this exhortation to believers, and the context here is within the body of believers. Colossians 3, 12 to 17. Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness and patience, bearing with one another. And if anyone has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you must also forgive. And above all, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Let's ask God's blessings on this evening service. Father God, I just want to thank you for your love and your mercy towards us. Father, I thank you so much for your Son, Jesus. Father, I thank you that we can just come here in this place and praise your name and lift you up. Father, I ask blessings on tonight's service. I ask that you just speak through Dane tonight. As he teaches us, I pray, Father, that you open up our hearts that we may be attentive to what your Holy Spirit has to say to us this evening. May you just bless this service. I pray that your name will be glorified in this place tonight. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Let's remain standing as we sing our first couple songs.
Sometimes our circumstances in life force us to turn to God. And as we do, and we see God's victory and power in our life, then we have the opportunity to sing, "To God be the glory." Let's sing this together. Please be seated.
Good evening, everyone. Hope you're having a good night. So, in preparation for tonight's sermon by Dane, I'll be reading from Malachi 4. So, Malachi was written about 500 years before Jesus' birth, and although the author is unknown, some believe it was Ezra. And it prophesies the day of judgment yet to come. So, listen closely as I read. So, Malachi 4. Surely the day is coming, it will burn like a furnace. All the arrogant and every evildoer will be stubble, and the day that is coming will set them on fire, says the Lord Almighty. Not a root or a branch will be left to them. But for you who revere my name, the Sun of Righteousness will rise with healing in its rays, and you will go out and frolic like well-fed calves. Then you will trample on the wicked. There will be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day when I act, says the Lord Almighty. Remember the law of my servant Moses, the decrees and laws I gave him at Horeb for all Israel. See, I will send the prophet Elijah to you before that great and dreadful day of the Lord comes. He will turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the hearts of the children to their parents, or else I will come and strike the land with total destruction. So when I first read this passage, it reminded me of the power that the Lord God has over everything, his wrath, but also his love for those who fear him. Recently, I've been thinking about what it means to fear the Lord. And verse 1, made me think of that probably the most. So verse 1 reads, surely the day is coming, it will burn like a furnace. All the arrogant and every evildoer will be stubble, and the day that is coming will set them on fire. So when I was studying this, I realized that as Christians and children of God, we do not need to fear the Lord on this day of judgment. So what does it actually mean to fear the Lord? So verse 6 reads, he will turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the hearts of the children to their parents, or else I will come and strike the land with total destruction. So as children of God, we need to turn to him as our parent. We need to, as children, seek the Lord, be in awe of his power, honour, serve, and glorify him. This is what it means to fear the Lord. Fearing God means having such reverence for him that God influences the way that we live, in everything that we do, the way that we talk, and the way that we act. On Judgment Day, when there is not a root or branch left, we can have comfort knowing it is our God, our Father, who waves his hand and controls everything. Please stand as we pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray for tonight's sermon by Dane. I pray that it reaches our heart and we are able to learn and grow in this together, Lord, for you. And I pray that we are able to fear you so that it may influence our life to better serve, honor, and glorify you. I pray, Lord, for the things that are happening around the world, the wars with Palestine, Israel. I pray for this, Lord. I pray that you are able to reach people through this hard time, and you give peace and comfort. I pray, Lord, that we are all able to spend more time with you personally and grow in you. Lord, please be with us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please remain
love.
Please be seated.
Singing, be seated. I like that. Upbeat and right on message for what I have to say this evening. Good evening, you guys. How you doing? We doing all right? I feel like we're the church is a ship, and I feel like we're loaded on one side. Maybe I got kind of do a little bit like this. thanks for the chance to share with you God's word this evening. Grab your Bibles, if you got them, and turn with me to Matthew chapter 11, if you would. I want to continue our study of the life of Christ. We've already in this series, if you can just think back, I think we've probably about 10 messages in, we've spoken of Jesus as pre-existent, the Son of God, as pre-incarnate. What was he doing during human history before he came in the flesh? As long expected, waited for in prophecies and in genealogies. I don't know if you remember that was Christmas Day, I think. And also in songs. And we've talked about baby Jesus, and we've talked about boy Jesus, And last Sunday in Russian, if you were there, what Jesus must have been like as a young man. And so now he's all grown up, okay? Now he's all grown up, and he's about to formally enter the ministry. But before we get to that, though, we've got to make a slight detour. It's just that all four canonical gospels insist that Christianity as a movement began not with Jesus Christ, but with John the Baptist, who served as his announcer, so to speak. Just a quick aside, why do you think that is? Think about this with me. Why do you think that Jesus had to be introduced to humanity? My generation in the States, I don't know what they show late night TV here, or even if anybody watches TV anymore, but my generation in the States grew up listening to the Tonight Show's Here's Johnny. I don't know if they ever showed that. They'd go, Here's Johnny. And then, like, later on today, still the Tonight Show, and they're saying, Here's Jimmy Fallon. Boxing has got its let's get ready to rumble. They've got, like, some sort of an intro that they give. I grew up in the 90s watching the Chicago, Michael Jordan of the Chicago Bulls, and they were the first ones to really do introductions right, and they would go, and now, put your hands together for the starting lineup of your Chicago Bulls, and then, like, you know, and then they would dim the lights and everything. They're the first to do that, and NBA teams since have been making a big production of introducing their players. It's almost out of control now with, like, jumbotrons and laser shows and pyrotechnics. And I was at the Power game last night. You know, nice breeze in the youth. And they had the pyrotechnics out there as well, right? So they're doing it here too. Even humble believers like ourselves naturally want to introduce a speaker, say, if the person's unknown or is especially important or unexpected. We do that, like if we get somebody from Anchor. I think it's, you know, nice to do. Why all the introductions? I believe it's because human beings, and think about this, this is true. Human beings have a real psychological need to be primed for something, for, you know, grease those wheels. Introductions help in different ways. Introductions help to provide continuity with what's gone before, to smooth transitions from this to that, to focus our attention on what's important now, and to lend credence with an endorsement. So think in terms of transition and endorsement. That's what introductions are for. John the Baptist accomplishes all of this for Jesus in his own unique way. And so anyway, I thought then, we'd swerve and do a short mini-series, so like a mini-series within the larger series. If we're going to speak about Jesus, you know, hundreds of messages or whatever, we can at least give four to John the Baptist, who started it all. So I just want to focus on this evening. Who was this guy, huh? John Ben Zachariah, or Ivan Zakharovich, right? Who was this guy? What was his deal? How did he go about things? And did that work out for him? Spoiler alert, it did not work out for him. Four messages should cover it. This evening, I just want to focus on John the Baptist, the man. And then on successive Sundays, we'll touch upon his message, and then his method, and then his murder, okay? So the man, his message, his method, baptizing. I think that's important for us who call ourselves Baptists. And then also his unfortunate death, his murder. Obviously, these topics kind of blend into one another. They overlap. Part of the man was his message. Part of his message could be found in his method. It was actually, the method itself was preaching something. And all three of these, man, message, method, they got him into deep, irreversible, irrevocable trouble with the authorities. Nevertheless, the the breadth of material we have to cover just fits under these headings. So that's how we'll proceed. First, let's read together. I'm going to ask you to stand with me, and let's read Matthew chapter 11. If you can go there, Matthew chapter 11, verses 7 to 15. Matthew chapter 11, verses 7 to 15. John has just been apprehended by authorities, thrown into prison. And here Jesus basically pays a special tribute to the man. And he basically asks his audience, what did you expect? A happy ending with this guy? This is Palestine. This is in Hollywood, okay? And if we don't exposit the passage fully, it'll just get us underway. 11:7. As these men, like an entourage from John the Baptist, were going away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds about John. Would you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by a wind? No, but really, would you go out to see a man dressed in soft clothing? Those who wear soft clothing are in king's palaces, not prisons, is what he means by that. But would you go out to see a prophet? Yes. And I tell you, and one who is more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written, "Behold, I send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way before you." Truly I say to you, among those born of women, there has not arisen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence. Violent men are taking it by force. For all the prophets and the law, they prophesied until John. And if you're willing to accept it, John himself is Elijah who was to come. He who has ears to hear, let him listen. Amen. Have a seat. The little we know about John the Baptist suggests that he was a priest gone rogue. Remember that? He was supposed to be a priest. Clark Pinnock gives the following educated guess in an encyclopedia of the Bible. It's really good. He says this, and I'm quoting him, "John made an attempt at following the profession of his father." You got to remember that the Bible says Zacharias was a priest of the division of Abijah. Okay, and so he's going to follow in his father's footsteps, being under a solemn obligation to do so as a son, but was so disgusted by the political machinations and corruption he encountered in the priesthood that he concluded Israel deserved the divine wrath. Whereupon he separated himself from official religion and called upon men to form a righteous remnant. And I think that sounds about right as a summary of this man and what he did. To the casual Palestinian observer of John's day, everything about him would have screamed, not pampered priest, not the way he should have gone, but the severe dedication of a prophet of old. Where he lived, what he wore, what he ate, how he behaved, who followed him, all these things, and I have them under this sort of heading for us to go to go each one point by point. John the Baptist digs where he's from, right? Digs, dress, diet, demeanor, and disciples. All of these things would have fired the Jewish imagination that God had sent his messenger finally and was once again at work among his people after we heard 500, about 500 years. Malachi is the last book of the Bible, kind of ends with this sort of like, we're waiting for this guy, right? So let's look at each of these a little closer and see if we too can't connect the dots as well. So let's talk about where he's from, Diggs. All four of the Gospels situate John the Baptist in the wilderness of Judea, in fulfillment of Isaiah 40, chapter 40, verses 3 to 5. I'm going to read that. Isaiah chapter 40, verses 3 to 5. A voice is calling, "Clear the way for the Lord in the wilderness. Make smooth in the desert, a highway for our God. Let every valley be lifted up and every mountain and hill be made low. And let the rough ground become a plain and the rugged terrain a broad valley. Then the glory of the Lord will be revealed and all flesh will see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Although John grew up in the hill country of Judea, he had long since removed himself to the east in to its wilderness portion. So if you could just imagine, east of the Jordan was basically considered more of a deserted sort of wilderness area. That's where he spent his time. And there wasn't this move, when you think about it, like just an implicit condemnation of society. Every once in a while I get this kind of feeling myself too, I just want to, like, you know, just grab my stuff and go and just be gone from society. The less people I see, the better. I'm going to go homestead. I'm going to, you know, all that sort of a thing. I get that in. I think he had a little bit of this. It's also implicit is just a severe denial of self. There's nothing out there. There's nothing. Imagine, like, in a wilderness today. Imagine a wilderness then. Absolutely nothing. No kiosks, no Walmarts, no anything. And there's also an utter dependence upon God, because you are alone and you're just basically, it's survival mode. Actually, by this time, the wilderness had taken on a storied significance. It was the place where God took his people, whether corporately or individually, to test and to purify them for some maybe future service or occasion, if necessary. And that John the Baptist had lived a significant portion of his life in such desolation, really, meant that at the very least he would never have to demand of others that which he hadn't already kind of put himself through and experienced it, and that he wasn't himself committed to. So I think that's important. So that's where essentially he's from. The hills of Judea, but then he kind of removed himself to the Transjordan, to the other side, where it's just desolation. His dress. Both Matthew and Mark take special notice of how John the Baptist dressed. It turns out that he did not drape himself in velvet, a la Seinfeld's, George Costanza. Far from the soft clothing worn in king's palaces, John's garb was a scratchy tunic of camel's hair. And it was cinched at the waist with a strip of leather. I've gone to the, you guys have like, some, it's not a petting, just like a wild animal park out there, a gorge. They got the camels out there. Those camels will let you pet them. It's not comfortable. It's not your Hugo Boss. It's not, you know what I'm saying? It's not a Valentino. It's nothing like that, right? You don't want to sleep in it, whatever is made for you. Although the stitching may have been custom. But no one dressed like this, is my point. No one dressed like this, even in those days, unless you're trying to say something by the way you're dressed. There's people like that who like to make a statement by the way they dress, and this is one of those occasions as well. And what's interesting is that what we know from the Old Testament, we don't have to go there, just believe me on this one, I can give you the places, but this is how the prophets of old dressed, Zechariah 13:4, and it's how Elijah dressed in particular, 2 Kings 1:8. His diet, same authors, Matthew and Mark, mention the mainstay of John's diet, and I'm sorry we have to go all Bear Grylls hosting Fear Factor on you right now, but John lived off of locusts and honey. And these were, respectively, locusts and honey, think protein and sugar, right? That's, if you're foraging out in the desert, this is going to be your mainstay diet. Only sources, really, of those things. Mosaic law actually forbid the eating of winged insects. I forgot about that. I mean, you know, some of God's laws just kind of state the obvious. You know, you forget about it, but you weren't supposed to eat insects. But God did, however, make an exception for any winged insects that had legs above the feet. That's how the Hebrews would describe crickets, grasshoppers, locusts, very similar sort of animals. Locusts are just grasshoppers that like to party. They get together, they swarm, plagues, things like that. So, this was allowed, and this is what he ate. I guess John just sort of roasted the natum. I actually preached a long time ago on John the Baptist, my former church, and I did something for the kids where, like, I actually bought some locusts, you know, and made sure they were dead, and I got some honey as well, and then, like, we did, like, a vam slabo sort of a thing, like, would you eat? And one of the kids, James, actually, right in front of everybody, he dipped that locust in the honey, which is, I imagine, what John would have done, just to, you know, let it go down. And then he won himself like $5 or $10 or something like that. I forget how much I gave him for it. But yeah, creepy crawlies slathered in bee hurl. That's your, you know, I'll pass. Anyways, demeanor. Let's talk, okay, if that's not weird enough for you, moving on to peculiar behaviors of John the Baptist. In Luke 1, verse 15, the angel Gabriel predicts that John will drink no wine or liquor. If he's going to be filled with anything, the idea is if he's going to be filled with anything, he's going to be filled with the Spirit of God, so that there's no mistaking. And such abstinence suggests to some the dedication of a Nazarite, according to the special vow that you could take in Numbers chapter 6. If you look that up, and this vow also forbid one's hair to be cut or shaven for the duration. So it's possible that John had longer hair than most, and I think most of the time in depictions, it's because of that. You'll see it like that. Not many barbershops in the desert, anyway. John not only lived a life of abstinence, he also lived a life of celibacy. So no wine or women to complete the picture of self-denial. And we have no way of knowing whether he did this, that this was just kind of like, this was something natural for him, or whether this was, maybe a super added gift, or was perhaps a sacrifice that he made himself for the kingdom. We don't really know those things. All we can say, though, for certain, is that his singleness allowed him a greater dedication to his prophetic ministry. And this also probably contributed to the aura around him that he was Elijah reincarnate, because Elijah, as far as we know as well, hadn't married. Okay, and this gets us to a problem. A difficulty in the text, because both John the Baptist and Elijah the Tishbite, they retreated to the wilderness and worked the Transjordan area. So they went out there and they stayed out in that area. Both of them wore roughed out tunics, belted at the waist. Both, as far as we know, they never married. Both of them had groupies and understudies that if you kind of look, they're both trying to shed. They're trying to get rid of them, actually. And both of them spoke out against, and they ran afoul of tyrants. John spoke out against Antipas and his wife, Herodias. And it was Ahab and Jezebel. Remember Ahab and Jezebel? With Elijah. It's interesting. So very bold men spoke truth to power. In Malachi 4:5, why don't you turn there, or at least brothers in the back, if you can put that up. In Malachi 4:5, and we read it, God promised to send Elijah as a forerunner of sorts before the great and terrible day of the Lord. And all the synoptics, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they treat John the Baptist, at least provisionally, as this eschatological figure, as the promised Elijah. So why then in the fourth gospel, you got to turn there with me, in the fourth gospel, John denies that he is in fact Elijah to a delegation of Jerusalem, from Jerusalem. It's just hard to say. Turn with me to John chapter 1, verses 19 to 23. John chapter 1, verses 19 to 23. This is the testimony of John when the Jews sent to him priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" And he confessed, and it wasn't like he was denying, but he confessed, "I am not the Christ." They asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" And he answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? So that we may give an answer to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" And he said, "I am a voice of one crying in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah had said." So, again, the question is, why does John equivocate like this? Why does he hedge when he has seemingly tried so, I just showed you, he seemingly tried so hard to pattern his ministry after Elijah? A couple of thoughts here. And this is, like, some of the better commentators will just say, like, you know, don't really know. It's possible that Jesus understood John's role better than John understood it himself. I find that hard to believe because it seems like he's patterning his ministry after Elijah. But one is that it's possible that John is denying an exact one-to-one identification with Elijah the Tishbite. That he is Elijah reincarnate, that he is Elijah redivivus, that he is actually the historical figure, Elijah come back. Since Elijah, if you remember, he never actually died. Many thought that Elijah would return the same way that he left, like chariots of fire sort of thing. And John, who knew he had parents, would then be denying this overly literal interpretation of things as if this promised figure needed to be Elijah, the historical figure sent back. Like it says in Luke 1:17, the angel promises that John the Baptist would come in the spirit and power of Elijah. So this may be what he's saying, but if he's saying more than that, if John is also denying that he is the Elijah that was promised in the book of Malachi, we have a bigger problem. Maybe because he is only, if you read Matthew, he's only potentially that. He's only provisionally that. Jesus says, if you will accept it, if you will accept this, then he is the one. And I think that the reason Jesus says it that way is because, and we don't think about it that often, but the wrath of God that Jesus took for us on the cross is an eschatological wrath. It's why it says in 1 Thessalonians 1:10, I believe, Jesus who saves us from the wrath to come. That's because he took that eschatological wrath upon himself. So for all who would repent and ultimately believe, who would be touched by John's ministry, then that wrath of God no longer is upon them. It is revealed. It was revealed at the cross on Christ himself. And then there might need to be another instantiation of this prophecy. There would need to be another Elijah before Jesus came again to restore all things. And interestingly, if you read in Revelations chapter 11, there is a prophet who comes that is very much like Elijah. And there's two prophets, right? And there's one that's like Elijah and another one like Moses. You can read that on your own. I'm just saying our bases are covered either way. It's not that huge of a what might other otherwise be a contradiction or a discrepancy or something like that. So anyways, there you have it. The man Angel Gabriel said would be great in the sight of the Lord. The man Jesus said was the greatest figure ever to be produced under the old covenant, Matthew 11:11. So let that be an encouragement to you this evening, that heaven measures greatness in terms of dedication. This man ended his life imprisoned and then beheaded. Heaven measures greatness in terms of dedication. Heaven could care less about whether someone was wealthy or successful or good-looking or popular, all the above. True greatness isn't measured in those mundane earthly terms. And it's a good thing, too, because most of us aren't these things, right? No, true greatness is all about dedication. So think about yourself now. It's all about dedication to the Lord and how your life points to Christ. Are you dedicated to the Lord, and does your life as a whole point to Christ? Which fact, by the way, means that by God's grace, true greatness is within your grasp. I feel like we're saying this a lot. You only need to be the hero of your own story. God just wants you to have victory in your own life. You don't have to be this great thing, because that's not how heaven measures our whatever it is that we attain to. So I ask you, do people know who you are and what you're about without having to ask? When I was back home in Grass Valley, Nevada City, where I used to live, I used to always be reading my Bible in the cafe. So people kind of just knew. They could come up to me and they'd talk to me about whatever. They just knew I was a Christian because I was reading my Bible in public. Or even here more recently, when we had the Kiryankos with us, I thought this was sweet. We were in Henley together, and all of their family was gathered from Melbourne and everything, and they were starting to split up right from there, and we all kind of just huddled together like a football huddle with our arms around each other in the middle of Henley Square, and everybody was watching, and we prayed our way out of that, and I was watching the people who were sitting left and right what they were thinking. And I don't want you to go out there and kind of purposely do these things should just kind of come as you just live holy, joyful lives before the Lord. These things will stick out. But is that what your life is like? Like I said, everything about John the Baptist, right? Digs, dress, diet, demeanor, disciples, screamed Elijah the prophet. It was a committed representation his whole life. How about you? Does everything about you scream the one that you claim to represent? Or are you sending mixed messages? Are you holy and devoted to the Lord and living a joyful Christian life? This sort of thing is attractive. This is what the world needs to see. And this sort of language, it's not new, this language of representation. It's found everywhere in the New Testament. Believers are called Christians, which means little Christs, chips off the old block. Believers are Jesus' disciples, and that means that they learn from him and they follow him in absolutely everything. We are told often to imitate. Now, Paul says it a bunch of times, imitate me as I imitate Christ. We are imitators of him. We are his representatives, as it says in 1 Peter 2:21. Christ left us an example for us to follow in his footsteps. Too often you and I are content with shortcuts, I think. And I say this about myself a little bit too, like half measures, like just spiritual mediocrity, whatever it may be in your life, just some sort of glaring sin. These things, they cut into and they undermine our testimonies. Sure, we say that we follow Christ, but what is there that is truly compelling about our lives? We've all got a list of names that others have spoiled for us. I was talking to Joe, who's going to be naming one of his children coming up here pretty soon. Like, are there any names? Any names that just people just ruined it for you? And he's like, oh, yeah, but I don't want to say because some people are named that in this building. But no, but he didn't mean by that like, you were the ones that ruined it. Just like, you know, he's just like, because I got people, like, I grew up with, that it's like, oh, man, if I name my kid that, then I got to think about that person every time I say that kid's name, right? You know, and believe it or not, some of you are redeeming that name because you're such great people. But this, you know, but the person I'm thinking about, we all have got these names. You got them. Am I right or am I the only one? We sang this morning, On nas zil bradnimi, on nas zil druzyami, dal nam novoye imya, on nas zavut what? Christiani, right? We bear the name of Jesus Christ. Ask yourself, do I so live my life as to not spoil that for others, but commend that name of Jesus Christ? Because the reality is, you guys, it's that pagans, God help them, they run into us first. They run into Christians long before they ever come to know Jesus personally. Which makes us Christ's forerunners, right? Today. We are Christ's forerunners for today. We introduce Christ to a lost world. That's on us. So God give us the grace to learn from this great man of faith and to convince other people of the truth of the gospel, not just by the force of our words, but by the force of our actions, our character as well. Amen? Let's stand and pray. Heavenly Father God, I thank you, Lord, for your word. I thank you once again for, in this case, a great man of faith who's gone before us, Lord, and lived such a committed, dedicated life unto you, very, very severe sort of life, Lord, which we are not under oath in any way to live exactly as he did, Lord, but he certainly was sold out for you, Jesus, and he said, I must decrease, you must increase, and he pointed the way to you, Jesus, who saved us and solved all of our problems and just have given every believer a new life and meaning and hope. And we give you praise for that example. Lord, help us to live in a very similar way. Help us to be convicted by those who've gone before and done so well, I ask. And just bless us, Lord, as we ultimately leave this place, I'm sure, and try to be that salt and light to a lost world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Sure. benediction is from 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 15 to 16. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see, to him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen.